So I'm here with the Conservative Councillor for the Wych Ward, Robert Nemeth, also the Conservative candidate, parliamentary candidate for the last election.
Morning, Mark.
Yeah, welcome back to Later TV. So we're going to be chatting about our EU withdrawal, 31st of January. And maybe should we go back first to 2016? What are your thoughts on that? What are your reflections now that we're quite a number of years ahead?
Oh, God, it's an expansive subject.
Yes.
Well, a lot has happened in that 3 years. Yep, it hasn't been the most fun 3 years of probably all of our lives, I have to say. But I think the country is well on its way now to drawing a line under this, I hope.
Yeah. I mean, what particularly were your reflections in 2016? Because it looked like, I mean, obviously the government supported the Remain cause and everyone thought that it would be everyone would vote to Remain, and then obviously, you know, the public had a different idea about it.
People forget that. I mean, Cameron and Osborne were very pro-Remain, weren't they, at the time?
Yeah.
And their plan didn't work out.
There was a lot of resources put into that Remain campaign, significantly in terms of money spent.
Taxpayers' money as well.
There was a lot of money spent on that. But so where did they get it all wrong? Because are we now 3 years on, almost nearly 4 years on, are we kind of, did a metropolitan kind of elite, do they think one thing and then basically the rest of the country, or particularly in England and Wales, think another thing? Is that where we are? Because we've just had another surprise election result. So what's your thinking on that?
I think you've probably nailed it. That's probably the principal theme of Brexit, that London, places like London, Brighton, you know, Cambridge, Oxford, Canterbury, Exeter, these places were very pro-Remain, certain type of city that you can clearly link the dots on. And then outside of that, particularly up north, was heavily pro-Leave.
Yeah.
And so you see the same pattern in terms of what the prediction was on the vote and also what the result was.
Yeah. How does, you being a politician, how do politicians work with that then? We've got a new Conservative administration, an absolute humongous majority, could well be in power for 10 years with that kind of majority. How do you work with that? How do you satisfy the kind of the inner cities but also then kind of make sure that those people that voted Labour before, particularly, you know, in the northern cities and towns, how do you kind of...
The proof will be
bind them together.
In the pudding. It's as simple as that. I mean, we've had 3 years just pass, and even yourself just said that is a long time. I mean, 3 years has been a long time, hasn't it, since that vote took place?
Yeah. Lots
of people assumed that a line would have been drawn under this, well, two years ago, quite frankly.
Yeah.
So there's now 5 years, and you even said yourself maybe 10. So they have to get the policies right on both Brexit and running the country generally, one following the other, which was the claim throughout the election campaign, that Brexit had to take place and then the country itself could be, I wouldn't say tackled, but the work can be done to improve the problems we see in our everyday lives.
Yeah.
If the policies aren't any good, then lots of leavers are going to be very impatient with the government and about why they even voted leave in the first place.
Yeah.
So proof's in the pudding. It's as simple as that. Get the policies right.
And the Tories, they own Brexit now, don't they? So, I mean, you know, if it all goes wrong, there's going to be no... There can't be anyone to blame but the Conservatives. So Boris has got a bit of a responsibility there. So they've got to make sure that they get it right, but particularly because there's a lot of people that have played a big part of the Leave campaign, Dominic Cummings for one, that are now in the heart of government in 10 Downing Street. So they're really going to have to...
You're right, but I don't think it could be... happen in any other way. The democratic position is, if there's a vote on something, you implement that vote. So you're right that Conservatives did own it during the election campaign. But that's the democratic position anyway. So I would hope that most people who didn't like the result would have still embraced it, because it's a basic democratic principle.
Yeah. There was a big democratic mandate behind Brexit. I mean, I know there's been a lot of discussion about it, but if you look back, I mean, the Tories won a small majority, I think 13, under a manifesto that called for a referendum under David Cameron, surprise majority, but it was a small majority. So so they had that. But then there was the vote itself, which obviously the Leave campaign won. And then, of course, there was the election after that, whereby, you know, 80% of the votes cast were for Labour and Tories, and they were all pro-Brexit. So, and then, obviously, we just had a massive majority.
A collection of Brexit
different
mandates.
Votes. So there's the mandate for it is... It's huge, isn't it, really?
Well, of course, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's easy to forget that, living in Brighton and Hove. And I think, again, it comes back to this idea of what the thinking is outside of these bubbles.
Yeah. Do you think people now accept Brexit? And do you think a lot of the people that were part of the People's Vote campaign, I mean, I'm thinking of Gina Miller's...
there's a difference between embracing, you know, accepting and continuing to campaign against it. I mean, there's already talk of things like rejoin movements. But it's probably... Their success will solely rely on what the policies are post-Brexit and what's going to happen on 1st of February.
Yeah.
I mean, I think lots of people really do think their lives are going to fall apart on 1st of February.
Yeah.
The day after Brexit, which is just a couple of weeks away now.
Yeah. I mean, is there not going to be much difference? Because we're still going to be in that transition period. But, I mean, I guess it's more of an emotional thing in Brexit, isn't it? So people that voted to remain, they've obviously, that's not going to... It's very unlikely that's going to happen now. We've got the you know, bill going through Parliament, all the legislation. So it's an emotional thing, isn't it, rather than a practical thing for a lot of people. Is that...
Well, I think it's an emotional thing based on fears about bad things actually happening.
Right.
And if those bad things don't materialise, then I think people will think, why? What was the point of campaigning against it so strongly?
Yeah. So how would you like Brexit to progress and how do you think it's going to progress? I mean, what kind of Brexit would you like to see? Because I know we've spoken before about hard and soft Brexit.
Well, it's got to be gradual. That's the first thing. You can't have any sudden, they call them, you know, cliff edges, but... It's got to be gradual. You've got to take everyone with you. You've got to think carefully. You've also got to be firm. So you've got to set a date and go with it. So Boris Johnson achieved in, around 100 days what some people said would take, you know, a year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Most of these deals are fairly simple in their composition. The time limit is about the arguing. It's not like painting the Sistine Chapel that literally does take time. The length of time is about the brinkmanship.
Yeah. What about in terms of what you think's going to happen? Is Boris going to... I mean, I know you don't see it as being hard or soft Brexit, but do you think that we're going to be tied in terms of the conformity on regulations, for example, the regulatory environment for, like, medical device for technology? Do you think we're going to be aligned to the EU?
This, again, is the big question. Tied or aligned? I think... We would want to be aligned, so we choose to be aligned, so alignment would happen. Tying is the bad thing. We don't want to be tied on anything.
Yeah.
We would want to choose to do... All of our participation should be based on our tacit agreement on a case-by-case basis.
Yeah.
And that's the whole point of it. We should be able to take it or leave it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the whole point. We should be in charge of our own destinies.
Yeah.
And we would choose to be aligned, and... I'm sure the European Union countries would welcome us being aligned.
Now, immigration was a big issue, wasn't it, in that 2016 election. How do you see that playing out? Freedom of movement's meant to be coming to an end at the end of this year. I mean, that's going to be a big issue, isn't it, for some people that aren't, you know, British citizens, that people, they have to obviously register already. I mean, you can see that would be... cause uncertainty amongst some people, wouldn't it? Because...
Yeah, not just uncertainty.
It is going to be different.
Also upset. I mean, it does strike me as a distressing situation to be in. And the British government needs to speak in an embracing, you know, and conciliatory manner. And I think they have done so far.
Yeah. I know in other interviews in this programme, we've spoken about how, you know, both the EU and the UK governments could have done a lot more to guarantee EU citizens' rights. Because I know that the UK did try to strike out to... secure their rights early on in the negotiations, transition agreement, and that didn't happen. So how do you see that playing out in the future? Do you think we are going to guarantee their rights in a more kind of concrete way?
I would take it back to members of Parliament who undermined the government of the day's position were really playing... They were playing with people's rights by doing that. So it could, as you say, it could have been secured very, very early on, but as it became a game... by members of Parliament of all parties undermining, let's say, Theresa May, it made it very hard to agree anything.
Yeah. And, I mean, that was a big, massive logjam, wasn't it? No one saw that logjam coming, did they? I mean, looking back to 2016 again, who saw that? Who would have thought that we would still be barely moved on?
I think it's seen by anyone who has a general complaint about what they would call the, you know, the liberal elite.
Yeah.
And hearing that people would do anything to stop it.
Yeah.
And that was part of this, doing anything to stop it.
Yeah. OK, we'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We're going to be chatting more about the EU and the UK's withdrawal from that at the end of this month. Join us soon. Welcome back. We're here with Councillor Robert Nemeth, Wishwater Councillor for the Conservatives, also parliamentary candidate.
Hi, Mark. Hi.
So, the Liberal Democrats, they facilitated an election, didn't they, at the last election, for the Tories. Was that the right move for Jo Swinson? Because it didn't end too well for her, did it, up in Scotland with her parliamentary seat. But without Liberal Democrat votes, there wouldn't have been a general election, would there?
How that could have... There's loads of different scenarios how it could have played out against the context of a fixed-term Parliament Act.
Yeah.
And I don't think it had been tested constitutionally anyway till that point. So I don't agree with that.
Yeah, OK. So what? How do you think, if we hadn't had an election, what? Because there was a massive logjam in Parliament.
Yeah, a series of governments collapsing. I think that's what would have happened. Back-to-back governments having to collapse.
Yeah.
And the Queen having to step in and a mechanism happening to... for another election having to take place... just in a much more messy way.
But in many ways, then, the Liberal Democrats saved the day. But obviously, they formed a coalition government as well in 2010 with the Tories. So they've played their part in a kind of national conversation, national parliamentary system. But they don't get any credit for that, do they? They're paying the price for that, aren't they?
Yeah, I don't think they meant to save the day. I don't think it was about that. I think it was a cynical move to get an election off the back of their own polling numbers at the time in the hope of getting more seats.
Yeah.
And it didn't work out. Sadly for Jo Swinson.
Yeah. Revoke Article 50, I mean, I think even the Liberal Democrats themselves say that it was a complete disaster, wasn't it? Because it didn't
make sense. I felt sorry for Jo Swinson on this, because she was criticised for laying out her stall as to what she'd do if she became Prime Minister. And any party is allowed to do that, whether it be the Monster Raving Loony Party or UKIP or... you know, the Green Party, that's the game we're in. You make your pitch and if enough people back it, you get elected. And she was criticised for that. But I think she's perfectly right to say, if I was Prime Minister, this would happen. That's perfectly normal.
Yeah.
Jeremy Corbyn did exactly the same thing and he was a million miles off being Prime Minister as well, quite frankly.
Yeah. So why didn't that resonate, I wonder, the revoke Article 50? First of all, why? Because it was quite a... I think it had... quite a number of supporters, but nowhere near enough
to carry
the day in a lot.
Yeah, it didn't resonate because the country knows that Jo Swinson hasn't got a chance of becoming Prime Minister. So it's not even that it didn't resonate as a message, it's just it was never going to happen.
Yeah.
She never would have had enough votes.
To revoke Article 50.
Yeah. But I don't think people should be angry with her for that.
Yeah.
It's perfectly acceptable for a leader of a big party to say what they do if they became Prime Minister.
Yeah.
And we're at perfect liberty to take it with a pinch of salt.
Yeah. Tactical voting, it kind of worked, but not in the way that we thought it would. But obviously, the Tories benefited massively from tactical voting. As Boris Johnson himself has said that, you know, some Labour voters have lent the Tories their vote, as he said in his acceptance speech from 10 Downing Street. So tactical voting worked, but in a completely the opposite way.
Yeah, and time will tell if it's a lending or... No, I think it's more a giving, actually.
Yeah. Is that how you see that?
Yeah, because I don't think the Labour Party stands for what these guys and girls up north fundamentally believe.
Yeah, and we were there obviously on election night. I was at the count, latest TV was, you were there as well. I mean, were you surprised at that election result when that exit poll came in at 10 o'clock?
I was with the BBC, Sky News. Huge cheer in the room I was in at the time. So, yeah, very, very pleasantly surprised. But I still thought we'd win overall. I mean, there's no surprise on the Hove result. Overall, I was delighted.
Yeah, I was listening to some analysis from Gina Miller in the Guardian newspaper. She was saying that they thought that they'd lost it on the Monday before the election because loads of polling had come in. There was a big swing the weekend before the general election. So what do you think swung it for the Tories in that election? What clicked in people's minds? Because obviously, it's a massive majority. It might well carry them through the next decade.
I mean, I don't believe their polling. No one... Did you say 2 weeks before an election?
Just the weekend before four the election, days, Gina Miller is saying in the Guardian that the kind of her team thought that there was a big swing towards the Tories the weekend before. And then on the Monday, she thought that they would get a majority of about 30, 40 seats.
Yeah, but it was won on small margins in a number of seats.
Yes.
So you can't predict. We don't have the capability to even predict that anyway.
Yeah, but what's this majority mean for the country? Do you think?
Well, it means certainty. I mean, do you remember when after the 2017 election, before it was known that this would become such a long-running subject? I remember, Michael, as you know, I know Michael Gove from having worked for him in the past, and he launched back-to-back environmental policies that people from all different walks of life were saying, I love that policy, what a great idea. And it showed that what you can do almost in, let's say, peacetime with a decent mandate, not that they had a big majority, but they were able to run the government on a small majority, what can be achieved. And a specific focus was that, DEFRA, Department for the Environment. And I foresee a similar set of policies weekly. We're just going to see smart things coming out that we think, that's a good idea, brilliant. That's always niggled me. That's another injustice sorted. And that's how they'll play it now.
Yeah. So that Queen's speech, there was a lot packed into that, wasn't it? So the fixed term permanent, like we mentioned that at the start of the programme about, so that's going to go by the wayside.
Yeah, I mean, that's not an issue that...
It hasn't worked out, hasn't it, the fixed term permanent?
No, but that's not a household issue that annoys people, does it?
No.
You know, that's not a standard breakfast table discussion. But, it's the big subjects that they promised in the manifesto, things like 50,000 new nurses, you know, the biggest ever funding boost for the NHS. These sorts of things that were, lots of conspiracy theorists said that these things aren't real or true. And you'll see them now just rolling out these policies where Jeremy Corbyn said it's not possible, and now you'll see that it is.
Yeah.
Weekly, it will just happen.
Yeah, okay. You'll have to come on weekly, won't you? And then we got the police pledge was quite a big one, was it? 20,000 police. I mean, some people would say that, you know, the police were cut many years under previous government. So,
sorry to interrupt, but I don't think it's the case that some people say it. Everyone can say it. I don't have to try and cover that up or be embarrassed about it. They got cut because there wasn't enough money.
Yeah.
The Conservative government was tidying up the mess of the previous Labour government.
Yeah. So now we're going to be raising the police numbers. That's going to be a big thing. Do you foresee, is it the end of austerity? And do you think, as we know it, we had that whole programme, starting off from Cameron, we mentioned that before, coalition government, putting in the, and the Lib Dems did lose, they got some hits for that, didn't they? Jo Swinson, she was in government at the time. But are we past that period now, do you think? And we're into kind of more...
Yeah, 100%.
There's
no doubt about it.
Yeah.
I mean, during austerity, don't forget, the country was still overspending by tens of billions.
Yeah.
So it depends how you define austerity. But
yeah. Just before we finish up, then, so Brexit, what's going to how's it going to feel different then after the 31st of January, firstly, and then secondly, after 1st of January 2021. How's it going to feel different, do you think, for people?
Well, 1st of February, we'll be able to go back to remembering the day when we live in a democratic country. That's the first thing. And then for the next year, say, very little. And then after that, gradual. And it's going to be I'm just going to pick a figure out of the air, 10 years' time. Let's say 10 years, that's when you look back and think, oh, that was possible, that new relationship, that new deal. And that's where we're going.
Yeah. Do you think we trade deal with the EU by the end of the year? I mean, the EU is saying that they're not, it's not possible, but then they, I guess they did say that they weren't going to reopen the withdrawal agreement. The withdrawal agreement was open.
No, I've already said this. It's easily possible. It's not like it's not like painting the Sistine Chapel. Let's think of it like that.
Yeah.
The actual figures, it's just about arguing.
Yeah.
There's not actual work. It's not like building a bridge or something.
Yeah. Okay. And for Brighton, I mean, obviously we're kind of up 62% people voted to remain in Brighton. So big changes for Brighton, or is it?
I mean, hopefully we can tap into new tourist markets and we can just... Yeah.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Robert, thanks for coming in today. All the best for the future.
Thanks, Mark.